Did you know that the form of the nacelle of a wind turbine tells you something about the generator of that turbine? My name is Henk Polinder. I'm an associate professor at Delft University of Technology, and I'm working in the field of electrical machines and drives. In this lecture, we'll see how the energy captured from the wind is converted into electrical energy and fed into the electric power system. In previous lectures, we saw how to characterize the wind resource and how the kinetic energy contained in the wind is converted into mechanical energy by the aerodynamics of the rotor. Now, this mechanical energy has to be converted into electrical energy and fed into the power system. What are the requirements of the electric system that makes this connection? First, the turbine has a power curve, and that power must be converted into electrical power. Second, the system has to operate at a varying speed. Third, the power has to be supplied to the power system at a voltage and frequency of that power system. Fourth, this has to be done in a cost-effective way, minimizing the cost of energy. And fifth, there are all kinds of control, protection, and safety systems around this. The electrical system that makes this connection can be divided into two parts. First, the part inside the wind turbine, called the generator system. This system converts the mechanical power into electrical power. Second, a part outside the wind turbine, called the collection and transmission system. This system collects the power within a wind farm and transmits it to the power system. First, we'll have a look at the generator system. In wind turbines, different generator systems are applied. The most important difference is between geared drive systems and direct drive systems. In geared drive systems, the mechanical speed of the main shaft is increased by a gearbox to a speed of roughly 1500 rotations per minute. And then a high-speed compact generator converts the mechanical power into electrical power. In a direct drive system, the generator is directly driven by the main shaft of the wind turbine, so it rotates at a very low speed. The most important reason to develop direct drive systems is to get rid of the maintenance and failures of gearboxes. However, the consequence is that a large and expensive direct drive generator is needed. Both systems need a power electronic converter for the connection to the power system. The generators operate at a varying speed and therefore generate a varying voltage and a varying frequency. While the power system has a constant voltage and a constant frequency. A power electronic converter converts the varying voltage and frequency into a constant voltage and frequency. At full load, the typical efficiencies of gearboxes, generators, and power electronic converters are in the order of 97%. And at partial load, these efficiencies may decrease, especially for gearboxes. As an example of a wind turbine with a geared drive, the 3 megawatt Nordex N117 is depicted. We see the typical form of the nacelle of such a wind turbine. We also see the gearbox and a compact high-speed generator. As an example of a direct drive wind turbine, the 7.6 megawatt Enercon 126 is depicted, together with the generator of this turbine. As said earlier, direct drive generators are very large. In this case, the diameter of the generator is in the order of 10 meters. Because the generator is so large, the nacelle is built around this generator, giving it a different form. We'll now have a look at the collection and transmission system. For a single onshore wind turbine, this is normally done by connecting it to the power system using a transformer to increase the voltage level of the generator system to that of the power system. For a wind farm, especially offshore, this is more complicated. In a wind farm, a large number of wind turbines are generating electrical power. This power has to be collected within the wind farm, it has to be converted to the right voltage level, and then it has to be transmitted to shore. The way in which this is done mainly depends on the distance to the power system onshore. The offshore wind farm Egmond aan Zee, abbreviated as OWES, has a power of 108 megawatts. At 10 kilometers offshore, it's relatively close to shore. In this case, the power is collected at a voltage level of 33 kilovolts and transmitted to shore at the same voltage level. The Princess Amalia wind farm has a power level of 120 megawatts and is located at 23 kilometers offshore. In this case, after the power collection, the voltage level is increased to 150 kV to transmit the power to shore. The voltage is increased to reduce the transmission losses. A higher voltage leads to a lower current, and the transmission losses are proportional to the square of the current. The Barts offshore wind farm has a power level of 400 megawatts, and at 90 kilometers from shore, it can be classified as far offshore. In this case, after the power collection, the voltage level is not increased, not only increased, but also converted from AC, alternating current, to DC, direct current, using power electronics. The reason to use direct current for the power transmission is that using AC at long distances is not feasible because of the large reactive power consumption of the cables. Because the offshore power system does not yet exist, a lot of research is done to investigate what the best offshore power system would look like. Summarizing, we had a look at generator systems and wind turbines consisting of gearboxes, generators and power electronic converters. We also had a look at the power collection and transmission system for offshore wind farms. Good luck with the rest of the course.